It is our privilege to welcome our next speaker, Dr. Stephen Long, who my theology students will recognize as that author who told us God is not nice. Anyone? Steve, unlike God, is a little bit nice, and I think you will enjoy hearing from him this afternoon. Dr. Long holds the Carrie M. McGuire University Professor of Ethics at Southern Methodist University. He works in the intersection between theology and ethics and has published over 50 essays and 14 books on theology and ethics, including Divine Economy, Theology and the Market, The Goodness of God, Theology, Church, and Social Order, John Wesley's Moral Theology, The Quest for God and Goodness, Calculated Futures, Christian Ethics, A Very Short Introduction, I'm starting to get my colons and semicolons mixed up here. Saving Karl Barth, Hans Urs von Balthasar's Preoccupation, and The Perfectly Simple Triune God. With that, let's welcome Dr. Long.
I can never come on Wheaton's campus without getting a little nostalgic, because in 1983, I found myself married in Honduras, and a Methodist local preacher assigned to 14 churches. My wife was a nurse running a medical clinic out of our house. We'd just been married a few months, and our home was also our workplace. Wheaton College came down that year, and on their January mission trip, do they still do that, a January mission trip? And they built a clinic for us, which divided our workplace from our home, which was very beneficial for our marriage. So 34 years later, I thank you immensely for your help. I am smart enough to try never to disagree with Father Wynandy, and I usually find myself on the same side of him on most issues, so delighted for his many works and conversations. But obviously, as a Methodist theologian talking about ecclesiology, there will be some differences, as he himself mentioned toward the end, which of course are not personal, but have to do with the different traditions from which we arise. I've been in the situation where I am the lone Protestant in a largely Catholic audience, I am really grateful that you're willing to come and speak to us on this occasion. I remember my baptism. I was baptized at the age of 11 in the Church of the Brethren, just north of Goshen, Indiana, by a farmer preacher. The Anabaptists get Goshen, the Catholics get Rome. That just tells you a lot right there. As I recall it, he was a big man with rough hands, or so it seemed at the time. He submerged me three times in a baptismal pool, and one of the difficulties in low church traditions is sometimes the minister or clergy thinks that he or she has to do a lot of talking during the liturgy to make it effective. Each time he submerged me, he began to speak longer until I was convinced that I was going to die. By the time I came up after the third submersion, I was praying for resurrection. My baptism occurred under unusual circumstances. My family were not Anabaptists. We were Methodists. But we moved into a rural area north of Goshen, Indiana in 1970, and the Church of the Brethren was the closest church to our home. So the 2 years we lived there, we attended that church, a place where I remember when I remember my baptism. But how should I remember it? Into what was I baptized? A preliminary answer to that question is straightforward. I was baptized into the church, the body of Christ, and in so doing received the Holy Spirit. Baptism makes no sense apart from ecclesiology, pneumatology, and eschatology. The liturgy and or doctrine of nearly every church acknowledges as much. This is unsurprising because those liturgies and doctrines emerge from Scripture, from passages such as 1 Corinthians 12:13. For in one spirit we were all baptized into one body, Jews or Greeks, slaves or free, and we were all made to drink of one spirit. Every baptism is a baptism into the universal or Catholic Church, a church all Christians should confess faith in. It is good, I would suggest, that we confess faith in it because no one has ever seen it. And I mean that literally. No one can see at one time or from one location the fullness of the Catholic Church scattered throughout every nation and people in every generation. We are baptized into the Catholic Church, an object of faith. But that baptism only occurs through the mediation of a local church. These two, the local and the Catholic, are one. And to remember well any baptism requires understanding, requires remembering both the local traditions and the Catholic unity into which we are baptized. But no one can remember the Catholic unity per se. Any remembering of it must be in and through the local church. Relating local memory to Catholic unity is where matters become difficult and divisive. And so before entering into that difficult and divisive, let me begin with the local. For only in remembering the conditions that made our baptisms possible will any controversial account of the relation between the local and the Catholic make sense. So into what was I baptized? I was baptized into a local church, the Jefferson Brethren Church. Because of my family's brief presence in that church, I had no ongoing connection to it. I primarily remember two things about that church. I was baptized, and they discussed nonviolence a lot. I remember the latter more because of the conversations my parents had in the car after church. My father had served in the military. And in the military, he had overcome the racism that he and I were both baptized into in White County, Indiana. And I wish it had been the church that had challenged him with that racism, but in fact, it was the military. My father didn't find Christian discipleship in the practice of war contradictory. The Vietnam War was in full force during my baptism, and while my father affirmed the right of conscientious objection by the Mennonites, we even had a Goshen College student stay with us for a brief time, he was unconvinced by their pacifist witness. The war ended after I turned 15, and by then we had moved again and returned to the Methodist. When we returned to the Methodist, they didn't ask me to be rebaptized. They received my baptism. So my baptism was received at Knox United Methodist Church. And in so doing, they affirmed in part the local community that baptized me in the first place. They didn't ask me to repudiate or excommunicate the Jefferson Brethren Church. My reception then into the United Methodist brought some aspect of the Jefferson Brethren Church into the United Methodist Church, at least in practice, even if we cannot give an adequate theory for that practice. This should not be surprising because the history of the church itself is a complicated practice that often proceeds without a theory that sorts out all the confusions. Take as an example the history of my own church, the United Methodist Church. Like all practical histories of the church, it is an unstable blend of diverse traditions, mired in conflicts amidst their continuities. Now, we could extend this history to the conflicts within the Anglican tradition that gave rise to the Methodist. We could extend the Anglican history to the contested histories that make up the Roman Catholic Church that gave rise to the Anglicans. No historical practice of any church preserved some pure tradition immune to conflicts. If you've studied history, you know that. Now, time does not permit a detailed account of those conflicts, so I'll focus on one small part. The particular narrative of the United Methodist Church that made it possible for Knox United Methodist Church to receive my baptism from Jefferson Brethren Church. The United Methodist Church came into existence through the merger of the Evangelical United Brethren and the Methodist Episcopal Church, bringing together Reformed, Mennonite, Lutheran, and Anglican strands of the Christian tradition. The Anglican strand came from John Wesley, who started the Methodist movement and who is already cited today. It's seldom I go to a conference and hear John Wesley quoted favorably. That just warmed my heart. Wesley ordained its clergy, and he died in good standing with the Anglican Church. Make sense of that. John Wesley, an Anglican, not a bishop, ordained other clergy and was never disciplined by his church. I don't know how to make sense of that. The Lutheran strand came from the Evangelical Association that originated from Jacob Albright, who was baptized in the Lutheran Church but became a Methodist in 1790 and, while still a Lutheran, was licensed as a Methodist preacher. However, the English Methodists would not allow him to preach in German, and in turn, he established a German-speaking association that became known in 1816 as Evangelische Gemeinschaft, or the Evangelical Association. The Reformed and Mennonite strands came from the United Brethren Church. It arose from the Methodist work of two other persons of German heritage, Philip William Otterbein, who had been ordained in the Reformed Church and was well educated in theology. He read Hebrew and Greek, and Martin Boom, a Mennonite farmer who had no formal theological education. In 1766, the educated Otterbein heard the Mennonite Boom preach and was so moved that he responded to him with the words, "Wir sind Brüder," we are brothers, and thus the origin of the name, United Brethren. Boom had been elected as a bishop to the Mennonites in 1761, so he was a Mennonite bishop. But his work among the Methodists was not well received by the Mennonites. In 1800, he was excommunicated from the Mennonites. His excommunication was lifted by the Mennonite Church June 27th, 2016. He's no longer excommunicated. I have no idea what that means. That event was celebrated by both Methodists and Mennonites at Boom's Chapel near Lancaster, Pennsylvania. Now, these diverse strands flow into the United Methodist Church. The practical messiness of this history defies any simple, systematic ecclesiology. How is it possible to take all these strands with their incoherencies, confusions, and contests and iron them out into a comprehensive ecclesiological vision? And yet, for me to remember my baptism is to remember this history. It made me and my vocation possible. Its unity may not be found in a comprehensive ecclesiological theory, but it is found in people like me. The story of my baptism, like I assume the story of many, if not most of us here, was not a baptism into some lucidly coherent tradition or into a church that had maintained its purity since Jesus gave the keys to the kingdom to Peter. I did not know at the age of 11 that I had been baptized into a radical tradition of rebaptizers. Nobody remembers whether I was baptized as a child or not. I just find that sort of odd, but nobody remembers. They're just not sure what happened when I was a child. Into a people who had been perceived as such a threat to the political order that several centuries earlier, they were hunted down and killed by other Christians. I did not know my baptism was received by a sect that emerged within Anglicanism, that some have referred to as a Gallican form of Catholicism that refused to grant papal jurisdiction over general councils. Like all the local traditions into which we have been baptized, my baptism came in the midst of a story of division and conflict about which I was unfamiliar. I learned it after the fact. And it also, I think, occurred within continuity. So although we do not have, and I think do not need to seek, a comprehensive ecclesiology that could somehow smooth out the rough places of our ecclesial histories, nevertheless, naming the continuity between local baptism and Catholicity is an important, albeit not an easy, theological task. Rowan Williams, former Archbishop of Canterbury, gives us a basic principle to observe in naming the relation between the local and the Catholic. He stated, quote, "The entire church is present in every local church assembled around the Lord's table. Yet the local church is never the entire church." Now, if you find wisdom in this principle, as I do, then it brings with it theological encumbrances that should be observed in relating the local and the Catholic. And let me mention three, the three that will guide the rest of my reflections, I hope. First, any church that denies a connection between its local assembly and the Catholic Church misunderstands what it means to be a church. If the entire church is present in the local church, then every local church has a theological responsibility to explain that connection to the church. Answers will differ as to how a local church narrates the way in which the entire church is present in it. But each church is obligated to offer such an account. Several means are available to narrate that communion between the local and the Catholic Church: the episcopacy, ecumenical councils, scripture, the communion of saints, the Holy Spirit, eschatology, Christology. These means are obviously not mutually exclusive. But explaining some such means by a local gathered church to the Catholic Church should be a theological obligation. So I'll call this first encumbrance the local church is fit with the Catholic Church. It's an obligation. If a church refuses to do that, how could it call itself a church? Second, no local church should equate its existence with the entirety of the Catholic Church. While the Catholic Church is present in the local gathering, no single gathering place is the fullness of the Catholic Church. In practice, then, no local church can claim to be self-sufficient. If it is to claim the validity of its baptisms, then it should also be able to offer a theological rationale to its own members as to how the Catholic Church is visibly present in its gathering without the gathering itself hubristically claiming to be the fullness of Catholic unity. So I'll call this second encumbrance the Catholic Church's presence in the local church. I tried to come up with snappier titles for each of these encumbrances, but it just escaped me. Third, each church should be open to discernment on the adequacy of its answer to those who narrate that communion different than they do. And this third encumbrance is openness to ecumenical admonition. So I'll now remember my baptism into a Brethren church received into Knox United Methodist Church, as it is also a memory of the one Holy Catholic and Apostolic Church, by attending to these three encumbrances. The local church is fit with the Catholic Church, the Catholic Church's presence to the local church, and openness to ecumenical admonition. So let me begin with the first. I'll begin with an ecclesiology that makes sense of my local baptism by drawing upon a Baptist theologian, James William McClendon, who was a member of the Pasadena Church of the Brethren. McClendon's ecclesial situatedness was as confused as mine. He was raised Southern Baptist, but became discouraged by the racism he found in his church. He was one of the first Protestant theologians to be invited to teach in a Catholic Jesuit school, but was asked to resign, which he did, because of his opposition to the Vietnam War, even though McClendon had been a naval intelligence officer in World War II. In 1982, McClendon wrote an essay, "What is Baptist Theology?" in which he outlined the basics of a Baptist ecclesiology. Nearly two decades later, in 1998, 2 years prior to his death, he published an essay, "The Voluntary Church in the 21st Century," that advanced similar themes to his 1982 essay. These are the heart of his ecclesiology. Both essays look to Acts 2:16, Peter's address to his fellow Jews at Pentecost, as the biblical basis for a Baptist ecclesiology. In explaining that the disciples were not drunk, since it was only 9 o'clock in the morning, you know, what if it had been 5? You know, it's like, well then, yeah. No, it's never happened. In explaining that, Peter said, quote, "No, this is what was spoken through the prophet Joel." Now, McClendon takes the structure of Peter's claim, "This is that, this is what, this is that," as the basis for his Baptist ecclesiology. Peter points to a present reality, Pentecost, this, and he interprets it in terms of something prior to a that. McClendon moves from the specific instance of this in that as that in Acts 2 to a general ecclesiological claim. What occurs in the local gathering, the this, is nothing less than an instance of both the gathering of the primitive church, the that, and the eschatological community coming together. This is that. The only space and time we can inhabit, says McClendon, is the this. So you have to gather the church. If no one gathers, would there be a church? But the this that is gathered is not confined to this location, space, and time, because it's also an eschatological and a primitive reality. This is that. McClendon writes, quote, "The Baptist vision is none other than the shared awareness of the present Christian community as the primitive community and the eschatological community. In its present gathering, it is connected to the past and the future, making it more than it would otherwise be. The primitive connection," he goes on, "has Jewish roots. This is that is a reminder of Passover." On another occasion, when he explains this is that ecclesiologic, he refers to Deuteronomy 6, 20 and 21. "When your children ask you in time to come, what is the meaning of the decrees and the statutes and the ordinances that the Lord our God has commanded you? Then you shall say to your children, we were Pharaoh's slaves in Egypt, but the Lord brought us out of Egypt with a mighty hand." The present community was already contained in the primitive people of God, and so the present community can point to it and say, this is that. Another example McClendon uses to explain his this is that ecclesiologic is the Roman Catholic theology of the Eucharist. It helps us understand what is going on when the local church gathers. Now, McClendon's use of this is that contributes to his voluntary ecclesiology. But the church is not a liberal voluntary society created by free autonomous individuals who come together and make a social contract. It's not the voluntariness that constitutes the church. The church, he argues, is gathered. And if it's gathered by someone. Its voluntariness comes in the fact that someone gathers it. He cites the Methodist theologian Harris Franklin Rawl, connecting his Baptist ecclesiology to Methodism. Rawl distinguished between the given church, which was the existing institutional church of England, spread in its parishes across the land, with the gathered church. The gathered church depended less on parish boundaries, was free from establishment, and identified the church by the material gathering of persons. So it's the gathering that's gathered that constitutes the church rather than parish boundaries. The given church existed independent of gathered persons. The gathered church only exists in its local particular visibility. Now, McClendon admits these terms are fluid. The given becomes the gathered, the given, you know, the gathered Southern Baptists become the established church of Texas. I've discovered that now that I'm a Texas citizen. He also identifies the gathered church as a condition for witness. He writes, quote, "I do believe the term gathered church bears an ongoing witness. Its passive verb form declares that it is not we who gather, but God who gathers us. The church is called out before it can call others. It is gathered before it witnesses to God on earth. For McClendon, then, the church is foremost a freely gathered local body. It is voluntary in the minimal sense that it is not a function of the government. It is not established. It does not receive tax support. It does not seek to impose its will upon all people through the force of the state. But McClendon rejects a voluntarism in which each church, each local church, thinks itself free to make autonomous decisions, because the local church is also Catholic. The free church takes the call to share discipleship on all its members as a distinctive feature. This is what characterizes his Anabaptist ecclesiology. For him, there's no two-tiered ethic, one for the religious called to counsels of perfection, and another for those called to the precepts of ordinary life. All are called to gospel witness as the call to shared discipleship. The basis for discerning scripture to a life of shared discipleship is found in the form the local church takes, quote, a free common life in Christ in gathered reforming communities. So for McClendon, the church is semper reformanda. The free church affirms liberty, but it's not a negative liberty. It's not a liberty of non-interference. It's a liberty born out of the call to discipleship directed to the full maturity of Christ. McClendon emphasizes the local voluntary church. By no means, however, does he reject a visible presentation of the Catholic in the local. But it is not identified by bishops, councils, or a deposit of faith passed down and received in each generation without rupture. Catholicity is identified by faithful discipleship made possible through the Holy Spirit, producing a communion that is at one with the primitive and eschatological community. And it will be features of the primitive and eschatological community that allow you to identify conceptually the church and its faithfulness. McClendon poses a question that acknowledges the problem that his emphasis on a local gathered church can face. He says, but what keeps the local church from falling into heresy and schism? It's an important question. None of us want to be heretics and schismatics. I used to go to confession when I worked with the Jesuits, and I would confess that I was in schism, but I didn't want to be. And I once had a Jesuit confessor forgive me. And he can't do that, can he, Father Wynandy? Forgive me for schism. A confessor.
I guess not.
Yeah, so I have no idea what that means either. I have a lot of questions for Jesus when... Now, McClendon's answer is found in what was already alluded to, the maturity in Christ, recognized by the presence of the gifts Christ gives to the church in Ephesians 4, 1 through 16. Quote, the gifts Christ gave were some would be apostles, some prophets, some evangelists, some pastors and teachers to equip the saints for the work of ministry, for building up the body of Christ until all of us come to the unity of faith and the knowledge of the Son of God, to maturity, to the measure of the full stature of Christ. So only as the church moves towards this full stature, according to McClendon, can it be said to avoid heresy and schism. If it's moving towards that full stature, you can't accuse it of a heresy and schism. If it's falling away from it, it's probably heretical and schismatic. Now, McClendon offers a compelling theology of the local gathered church. He helps me remember well what happened during my baptism at Jefferson Brethren Church. His work is faithful to the first theological encumbrance noted above. He connects the local voluntary church to the Catholic Church through eschatology and Christology. The local church, he acknowledges, should avoid heresy and schism. It does so by seeing the Catholic in the local gathering, by using the gifts Christ gives to move the faithful to the measure of the full stature of Christ. The unity of the local and Catholic is found in Christ. No faithful Christian could disagree with that claim. Who wants to say, no, it's not found in Christ? Of course, Jesus is always the answer. But is this adequate as a visible presentation of Catholic unity in the locally gathered church. The Ephesian passage points also to something McClendon overlooks, the importance of ecclesial offices, apostles, prophets, evangelists, pastors, teachers. McClendon left that role unexplored. He had little to no theological time to set forth a role for an ecclesial office that would visibly represent the unity of the Catholic Church in the local church. He did not provide much of a theological rationale as to how the Catholic Church, then, is present in the local church. Is there a way forward that could affirm the central place of the free, gathered ecclesiology of the Anabaptists with its emphasis on a call to discipleship for all and its emphasis on holiness? And something that could also offer something more concrete on how the unity of the Catholic Church is present in the local gathered church. If only we had something like a high church Mennonite approach to ecclesiology. Then we could affirm both McClendon's Baptist ecclesiology and satisfy more fully the second encumbrance noted above, materially representing the Catholic Church's presence in the local church, so that the local church doesn't have to bear all the burden of Catholicity. So what I'm looking at is a Catholic Anabaptist ecclesiology or an Anabaptist Catholic ecclesiology, which has something to do with my own autobiography and my history and helped me make sense of this theologian I met in seminary. Peter Dula, a Mennonite theologian, met Stanley Hauerwas as a prospective student in 1997 and recounts the encounter. This is an encounter many of us had the first time we met Stanley. Peter writes, quote, "We had barely introduced ourselves when he said gruffly, 'When are you Mennonites going to give up and admit that you need a magisterium?'" End quote. Hauerwas is well known for his claim to be a high church Mennonite. As Dula notes, few Mennonites take this claim seriously. Dula refers to it as an internal conflict, not as a coherent position. Few Catholics or Orthodox take it seriously as well. Some Anglicans have, in particular Hauerwas' co-author, Samuel Wells. Gerald Schlabach, a Mennonite turned Catholic, has taken it seriously and offers a succinct interpretation of Hauerwas' claim. He writes, quote, "Hauerwas' project is to call Catholics and Protestants to be more Anabaptist and to call Anabaptists and Protestants to be more Catholic," end quote. That's actually Gerald's public version of that statement. What he really said was Hauerwas' project is to call Catholics to be more Anabaptist, Anabaptists to be more Catholic, and nobody to be a Protestant. But he's changed it, and it's probably better this way. Dula is not unsympathetic to Hauerwas' ecclesiology. He notes that Hauerwas really doesn't have an Anabaptist ecclesiology. He calls upon Anabaptists to be for and against Hauerwas, just as Hauerwas is against Mennonite ecclesiology. And although he finds High Church Mennonite incoherent, he also acknowledges it expresses a tension that should not be resolved. He notes, however, that Hauerwas has been invulnerable to any Anabaptist ecclesiology, and by beginning with McClendon's ecclesiology, I have attempted here to affirm, at least in part, an Anabaptist ecclesiology. But I also think Dula has been inattentive to Hauerwas' Methodist context. Hauerwas did not invent High Church Mennonite. As Michael Cartwright, a Methodist theologian, recognizes, what offers a better interpretation to Hauerwas' claim is his Wesleyan Methodist heritage. It's Albert Outler who said that the Methodist ecclesiology is an unstable blend of Anabaptism and Anglicanism. On the one hand, a Wesleyan ecclesiology shares with the Anabaptist that the church is free, disestablished, identified by discipleship and the pursuit of holiness. McClendon saw the consanguinity between that ecclesiology in Rawls and Anabaptists. But on the other hand, it's an episcopal ecclesiology in which the church's being is received, mediated to it through the office of bishop and priest presiding at the sacrament. In its emphasis on freedom and disestablishment, emphasizing the gathering of the local congregation, it approaches the Anabaptists. In its emphasis on the place of the bishop as a mark of the church's Catholicity, it is high church. The United Methodist Church places the mission of Catholicity within the episcopacy. Its Book of Discipline states, quote, "The role of the bishop is to be the shepherd of the whole flock, and thereby provide leadership toward the goal of understanding, reconciliation, and unity within the church, the United Methodist Church, and the Church Catholic. To do this, bishops are authorized to guard the faith, order, liturgy, doctrine, and discipline of the church. At the same time, it subordinates the bishop to the conference, which is best understood as a conciliar form of lay and clergy authority emerging from the local church. The bishop, even the council of bishops, is not a monarch or authoritative ruler who acts independent from the local gathering. Ecclesial authority is complex, messy, mired in conflict, a complex space where no single authority, local church, conference, bishop, can impose his, her, or their will on everyone else. The gathered church, as McClendon suggested, receives its being from God. The reception occurs, as McClendon did not suggest, through ecclesial office, where clergy take authority from the bishop to order the church through word and sacrament. The church is ordered to holiness, but holiness is never a secure possession that can be produced simply by right order. Right order does not guarantee holiness. The holiness of the local church should take precedence over ecclesial office, challenging it when order inhibits holiness, as it did when it excluded women from the office. In that sense, I'm working on a theme by Hans Urs von Balthasar that he would not affirm with me. He said that the Petrine vocation of order must serve the Marian vocation of holiness. I like that very much. And I think I could use that for defense of women's ordination, which would not please Hans Urs von Balthasar, I recognize. It might please Karl Barth, though, his good friend. Okay. Where am I? Here I am. So office unites local churches by guarding faith and practice, by ensuring the local church does not claim for itself the entirety of the church. But it only does this as it is attentive to the conditions that make for holiness within the particularity of the local gathering. Now, for those of you who might be surprised that I usually don't defend the United Methodist Church, but I like doing that today because I think there's something of real value here. But I'm not arguing that the Methodist ecclesiology is the true church, that it alone possesses the fullness of faith, and that the truth of all other local gatherings are validated by the fact that they subsist in this putative true church. The church is an object of faith. Seeking for the only true church, I want to suggest, is a theological mistake. Now, Hauerwas and Wells are explicit in rejecting such a search. After laying out criteria for what constitutes the church, they ask, which church, small c, is the church, big C? And their answer, I think, should not be forgotten. Quote, "It is an understandable question, but not a helpful one. It's unhelpful because it encourages a sense of finality that diminishes rather than builds up the church. This is a finality that suggests it is possible to arrive at a right church. Such a church would be almost bound to foster pride rather than honesty, complacency rather than confidence. It would resemble a too tidy dogmatics in that it would provide such a conclusive guarantee of God that witness would seem unnecessary and service would be neglected. It would misunderstand every aspect of worship." What we should avoid, and I think it's very difficult and hard to avoid, is the search for the right church. Hauerwas's and Wells' non-systematic ecclesiology should not cause us to neglect discussion of the third encumbrance, openness to ecumenical admonition. Their ecclesiology is not a neutral arbiter that hovers above the fray of ecclesial conflict, nor is it simply an affirmation of pluralism. It reflects the Gallican Catholicity affirmed perhaps by de Lubac and Congar and present in the Anglican Communion, an ecclesiology that has a place for but limits the authority of the Bishop of Rome. Now immediately opposition will arise, and from different sides. The first arises from a low ecclesiology present in non-denominational evangelical churches, and sometimes an Anabaptist one, that suggests that the only thing that matters is the local church. It is adiaphora to ask how the local church communicates Catholic unity, or even to seek ecumenical admonition. Even providing a place for the Bishop of Rome, or any bishop, as the office of unity goes too far. The second comes from Roman Catholicism. Many Catholics recall that the consistent teaching of the Roman Catholic Church is that it alone represents the true church. Now, those of us outside it are no longer heretics. And that's a great gift for which I'm immensely thankful to Vatican II. But we lack the fullness of faith because we are not in communion with the one church of Christ. The change in Vatican II that no longer anathematized us did not fundamentally alter that claim. The document Lumen Gentium maintained that the church is a single reality, end quote. And that's what Catholicism wants to preserve, that the church as the body of Christ must be a single reality. And as such, it, quote, subsists in the Catholic Church, which is governed by the successor of Peter and by the bishops in communion with him, although many elements of sanctification and truth are found outside of its visible structure. These elements, as gifts belonging to the Church of Christ, are forces impelling toward Catholic unity, end quote. Now, someone is sympathetic to Hauerwas's High Church Mennonite ecclesiology and open to ecumenism as William Cavanaugh will still understandably be faithful to the teaching of the Catholic Church. He writes, quote, "The breaking down of barriers between non-Catholics and Catholics in the post-Vatican II era should be recognized as an unqualified gain." Those of us who've taught in Catholic institutions know it's an unqualified gain, a great gift. But to describe this movement, he says, as an embrace of the world by the church is misleading. The idea that you sometimes find in Catholic circles that the great thing about Vatican II is it opened the windows and, you know, the world came rushing in and Catholics say, hey, this is pretty, we love the world. They love the world prior to Vatican II. He says, the ecumenical movement from the Catholic point of view is rather a recognition that those who were previously anathematized as belonging to the realm of perdition and not to the church are now recognized as belonging to the one church of Christ, even though not yet in full communion with the Catholic Church. So whatever grace was mediated to me at my baptism, in some sense was mediated because it subsists in the Catholic Church. Was the grace mediated by my baptism at Jefferson Brethren Church, made possible by the fact that somehow mysteriously it subsists in the Roman Catholic Church? Now, I'm grateful for the fact that Roman Catholicism, if I became Catholic tomorrow, I would not have to be rebaptized. My baptism would be acknowledged. I was somewhat surprised to find that in Uganda, as the bishop said this morning, that both Catholics and Anglicans require rebaptism. That's a bad practice by both churches. That's simply not what is supposed to take place. That's an error. If I became and I gave one daughter to the Roman Catholic Church, so I should get some credit for that. But if I became Catholic tomorrow, they would accept that the United Methodists accept my Mennonite baptism. That's messy. That's complex. But I'm grateful for it. What does it mean? If I were to become Roman Catholic, convinced that it alone is the one true church, they too would honor my baptism. They wouldn't ask me to repudiate it. And if that's the case, then it seems to pose a difficulty. And this is really all I can leave you with, is this difficulty. On the one hand, the Roman Catholic Church acknowledges the Catholicity of my baptism on its own terms. That farmer Mennonite who dunked me three times in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, what he did is valid. On the other hand, the Roman Catholic Church teaches that this acknowledgement should impel me toward the fullness of faith by entering into communion with Rome. But if the first is true, then what is the force of the second? And if I accept the second, how do I not betray the baptism I received at the hands of the Anabaptist preacher that was received by the United Methodists? Thank you.